Good morning, everybody. Great. Shall we get started? Can you hear me? Yeah, good. Okay, great. Well, our last lecture, that went fast, or my last lecture, I should say. So thank you to everybody in advance for taking part in this maiden voyage of this course. It's been wonderful for me, and I know I speak for Tony as well, to be able to discuss these issues with all of you. Today is a grand finale, I hope, for our discussion of economics in a good society. I'm going to talk about sustainable development as a normative goal and an urgent need, and talk about how the sustainable development goals fit within the framework that we've been discussing of economic ethics. If you'll let me share my screen, we will get started. So let me do that. And so today, our subject is sustainable development on a healthy planet. Our society is not healthy, and our planet is not healthy environmentally. And of course, COVID-19 is a symptom of much that is difficult in our world today, and also a major challenge for us going forward. I'll start by sharing the reflection of Ed Wilson, E.O. Wilson, the environmental biologist at Harvard University, one of the world's great thinkers and public intellectuals, who described our situation in the present day in the following way. He says that humanity today is like a waking dreamer, caught between the fantasies of sleep and the chaos of the real world. The mind seeks but cannot find the precise place and hour. We have created a Star Wars civilization with Stone Age emotions, medieval institutions, and godlike technology. We thrash about, we are terribly confused by the mere fact of our existence and a danger to ourselves and to the rest of life. And what I would underscore here is the Stone Age emotions, medieval institutions, and godlike technology. What Professor Wilson is signaling is three different time dimensions of our lives. Our Stone Age emotions are our basic human nature, forged in the long epochs of evolution, which give us our brains, our psyches, our abilities to socialize, our tendencies to a us versus them mentality, our deep human nature that enables us to find a path to good, but certainly does not ensure it. Our medieval institutions, like the U.S. Constitution, adopted in 1789, so 232 years ago, struggles to adapt. It was an ingenious institution that tried to take account of our Stone Age emotions. The Federalist Papers describes how the vision of the Constitution was a vision that meant to take into account the human capacities for good and ill. But this is a medieval institution at this point. As much as we praise it, it's out of date. as constitutions almost inevitably are. And many of our institutions, our venerable institutions, are hundreds of years old, but created in eras vastly different from our own. And of course, the third time scale that we face is that of technological advance. We have just gone through roughly 25 turns of Moore's Law. Moore's Law, you'll remember, is the idea that the computing capacity doubles every 12 to 24 months, measured in a variety of ways. For example, the number of transistors on a silicon chip. And that doubling and doubling and doubling over the period from the 1960s until today has given us billions fold increase of computation capacity, connectivity around the world, biotechnological capacity, so that not just one, but a dozen effective vaccines could be developed against COVID-19 within a 12-month span, something unprecedented scientific history. But technologies that are therefore not under control, under control of our Stone Age emotions or our medieval institutions. And our challenge fundamentally is to harness our human nature, our political institutions, and our technologies for the good. And that is what economic ethics needs to be about: understanding our human nature, understanding the institutions by which we produce and allocate economic goods, and understanding our capacities, our know-how, our technology, and direct it towards the good. Well, as Professor Wilson says, we are terribly confused about all of this, and that is our biggest challenge. So the good news is that the world is certainly rich enough to end all deprivation. We could end extreme poverty without much effort, in fact. We are clever enough to do so while saving the biosphere. By that I mean we have technologies for food production, technologies for energy production, technologies for recycling and for resource efficiency that enable us to have a prosperous economy alongside a sustainable planet. But the question is whether we are wise enough, whether we have the judgment, the phronesis, as Aristotle would have said, to end deprivation and to save the biosphere. That is the challenge that we are facing, and it's the question that we face is whether we have the wisdom to do these things. It's easy to show that poverty is readily controllable, indeed that it could be brought to an end. Most estimates of the number of people living in extreme poverty in the world today put the number at between 500 million and a billion people. And it's plausible to say that their basic needs for food, for basic primary health care, for education, for their children, for safe water, requires on the order of perhaps an incremental $1,000 for each of perhaps 1 billion people to meet their basic needs. And if you just do the basic multiplication, that's roughly $1 trillion a year that is the gap, the poverty gap facing people living in extreme poverty. That extra $1,000 wouldn't bring them to American living standards, material living standards, but it would meet basic needs. And that $1 trillion is not only manageable, it is a mere 1.1% of the estimated gross world product or gross global product for 2021, because the gross global product is about $94 trillion. So for about 1.1% of world output, it's really plausible to say that the basic needs, food, primary health care, water and sanitation, a place in school for every child, could be fulfilled. We don't do it, but how easy it would be to do. Another metric that is worthwhile is based on the recent Forbes wealth list that we talked about earlier in the course. The new calculation is that the 2,755 billionaires on the planet have a combined net worth as of March 2021 of $13.1 trillion. So the $1 trillion needed to end poverty is approximately 7.6% of the wealth of the billionaires. But the wealth returns are averaging certainly 7.6% per year for the wealthy on the planet. Just out of the income stream for 2,755 people, it would be possible to end mass misery. Again, we're so far not smart enough to do it. These wealth holders are not smart enough to put their money that way, and we're not smart enough to tax their money for that purpose. But if we did, we could alleviate mass suffering in the world. The idea of sustainable development is essentially to do these things. I interpret sustainable development as meaning economic prosperity, which means economies that deploy our advanced technologies, combined with human rights, and especially in this case, economic rights, rights to the basic goods that are necessary for human dignity and well-being, or as the UN puts it, no one left behind, combined with environmental sustainability. So sustainable development means this triple objective: economic, social or human rights, and environmental sustainability. It's a good idea. It is, to my mind, the basic ethical framework that we need for managing and directing and steering our economic resources in the years to come in this era of godlike technologies. So, as we've discussed earlier, the UN member states have adopted specific goals in this direction. That by itself is a small miracle, that 193 governments, some of them not so pleasant, some of them poorly directed, some highly corrupt, did coalesce in a three-year negotiation to adopt 17 goals specifically directed at achieving economic prosperity, economic rights, and environmental sustainability. Those 17 goals are part of Agenda 2030, which all of you should read in entirety. It's called Transforming Our World, the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. When it was announced in 2015, 2030 seemed a lot farther off than 2030 seems today. No doubt the SDGs will be followed by another set of objectives after 2030, perhaps up to mid-century. But the 2030 agenda says that this is a plan of action for people, planet, and prosperity. It also seeks to strengthen universal peace in larger freedom. We recognize that eradicating poverty in all its forms and dimensions, including extreme poverty, is the greatest global challenge and an indispensable requirement for sustainable development. All countries and all stakeholders, acting in collaborative partnership, will implement this plan. As we embark on this collective journey, we pledge that no one will be left behind. So you can see all of the different dimensions summarized in this preamble. People, planet, and prosperity. Prosperity is the economics. People is the human rights and human dignity. Planet is the environmental sustainability. And SDG number one, end extreme poverty. Big emphasis on partnership. All countries and all stakeholders will implement this plan. And then finally, we pledge that no one will be left behind. So the SDGs are a roadmap and, in my view, a normative framework, an ethical framework for us to operate. They are agreed by all countries of the world. That's extremely important. They are holistic, economic, social, and environmental. They focus on leaving no one behind. 17 goals, each one with multiple targets, adding up to 169 targets in all. And then 230 indicators have been identified as official SDG indicators. The SDG agenda is connected with the Paris Climate Agreement under the UNFCCC. The UNFCCC is the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, which was adopted at the Rio Summit in 1992. It went into force in 1994. It is therefore the governing legal structure for fighting climate change. At the 21st meeting of the parties, which took place in 2015 in Paris, the Paris Climate Agreement was adopted. And the Paris Climate Agreement essentially pledges all countries to cooperate to aim for warming at no more than 1.5 degrees Celsius in the 21st century. And that translates into ending greenhouse emissions that are warming the planet by the year 2050. All of this adds up to the last bullet point on this chart, goal-based development. The idea of the Sustainable Development Goals is adopt clear goals with timelines around them, and then mobilize the societal resources, financial, human, material, in order to achieve those goals. So it is a strategy of governance as well as a set of objectives. The idea is that our politics should be guided by specifically stated time-bound objectives. Why do we need SDGs and the Paris Climate Agreement? Because as we've discussed throughout the course, the economy does not by itself ensure economic justice or environmental sustainability. Markets do not ensure economic justice. They do not ensure that everybody has enough to eat. They do not ensure that there is basic social protection. They do not ensure that people escape from extreme deprivation. Quite the contrary, markets ignore the poorest of the poor and leave them to die. And so we need government active policies and strategies to ensure that nobody and no country is left behind. And markets do not address by themselves externalities like environmental destruction. In fact, market participants ignore those externalities, and it's only through collective action that the public good is aligned with the private activities. And so to address the environmental catastrophes, we need clear public purpose and public goals. The idea of goal-based development, in my view, is also a tactic of politics. It's a way to help people to understand the common good. By stating clear goals at a societal level, it's like making New Year's resolutions. It's a self-reflective process in which a society, in a shared and deliberative manner, or a world community in a deliberative manner, adopts clear objectives to pursue. So the mere process of deliberation, negotiation, and then formal adoption of shared goals, in my opinion, makes a very big difference. And I often think about and also like to underscore the idea of President John F. Kennedy in 1963 in a famous speech that we're going to watch a bit of in a few minutes, where he talked about adopting global goals and using that process to motivate global change. And he said, by defining our goal more clearly, by making it seem more manageable and less remote, we help all people to see it, to draw hope from it, and to move irresistibly towards it. So President Kennedy's idea was enunciate a goal clearly, show that it can be achieved, in other words, show that it's manageable, and that achieving it will bring real benefits, that it is not a remote goal, but something meaningful, then that will help people to see the goal, to draw hope from the goal, and as President Kennedy said, to move irresistibly towards the goal. It's a style of leadership. It's a style of leadership that President Kennedy, in particular, excelled at, because he called on Americans to adopt bold goals. And by doing so, he helped motivate Americans to move towards those goals. So that's, in my view, the idea of having the SDGs. It's really important to put the Sustainable Development Goals into perspective. And the perspective that I want to start with is that middle part of sustainable development, human rights, because I view the Sustainable Development Goals as part of the global human rights agenda. The idea of human rights, which we take as perhaps a commonplace, was itself a bold global innovation of the 1940s. Largely led by Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt. President Roosevelt had the idea to enshrine, even in the U.S. Constitution and in the U.N. Constitution, that is the U.N. Charter, the idea of basic human rights, but not only civil rights and political rights, but also economic rights. And this idea of human rights, I find to be perhaps the best modern synthesis of our ideas of justice that come from the church's teachings and from the ancient Greek teachings. The idea that there is a core human dignity and that recognizing that human dignity and the responsibilities of being a human being is what is conducive to our well-being, our eudaimonia, is an ancient idea that I think is best expressed in the modern idea of human rights, as long as those human rights bridge the civil, the political, and the economic rights. So I wanted to just put some perspective on this, if I could, and I'm going to stop sharing for a moment. I would like to share with you the origins of the modern human rights idea with Franklin Roosevelt in 1941. And let me see if I can do that. No. Yeah, it's a little frustrating, but let me try. Okay, let's see if this works. Can you see the screen?
Yes.
Yeah, good. Okay, now let's try and hope that the sound works. This is President Roosevelt enunciating for the first time at the beginning. This is early in World War I, the idea that there should be for every place in the world four freedoms: the freedom of belief, the freedom of speech, the freedom from want, and the freedom from fear. So the freedoms are freedoms of belief, civil rights, freedom of speech, political rights, freedom from want, economic rights, and freedom from fear, the right to live in a peaceful society. Now, tell me if you can hear this, which I hope will be possible.
The first is freedom of speech and expression everywhere in the world. The second is freedom of every person to worship God in his own way everywhere in the world. The third is freedom from want, which translated into world terms means economic understandings which will secure to every nation a healthy peacetime life for its inhabitants everywhere in the world. The fourth is freedom from fear, which translated into world terms means a worldwide reduction of armaments to such a point and in such a thorough fashion that no nation will be in a position to commit an act of physical aggression against any neighbor anywhere in the world.
Oops.
In the hand.
So that's quite a remarkable moment of history. That's President Roosevelt in a State of the Union address, 1941. World War II is underway. Hitler has conquered all of Western Europe and has nearly succeeded in invading Britain, but failed, not yet launched the Operation Barbarossa against Russia, which will take place in June. And Roosevelt, in his State of the Union to the United States, is talking about achieving for the whole world, everywhere in the world, freedom of belief, freedom of expression, freedom from want, and freedom from fear. And this is the beginning of the United Nations concept taking shape. It's an absolutely stunning political contribution, one of the greatest in American history for the world. And then 3 years later, President Roosevelt makes the following statement. He clarifies and elaborates the idea of economic rights. And he calls this, in the U.S. context, an economic bill of rights. So I want to play you the 1944 description of the economic bill of rights, because that's what ends up in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So let me do this as well. And can you see that?
In our day,
can people see this?
Yes.
Yeah, good. Okay, thanks. So this is Roosevelt. Now you see he's aged a lot in 3 years. Now he's speaking about economic rights.
In our day, certain economic proofs have become accepted as self-evident. A second bill of rights, under which a new basis of security and prosperity can be established for all, regardless of station or race or creed. Among these are the right to a useful and remunerative job, the right to earn enough to provide adequate food and clothing and recreation, the right of every farmer to raise and sell his products at a return which will give him and his family a decent living, the right of every businessman, large and small, to trade in an atmosphere of freedom, freedom from unfair competition and domination by monopolies at home or abroad, the right of every family to a decent home, the right to adequate medical care, and the opportunity to achieve and enjoy good health, the right to adequate protection from the economic fears of old age, sickness, accident, and unemployment, the right to a good education. All of these rights spell security. And after this war is won, we must be prepared to move forward in the implementation of these rights to new goals of human happiness and well-being. For unless there is security here at home, there cannot be lasting peace in the world.
How about that? That's amazing. And as you heard him say, this is all for happiness and well-being. So that is President Roosevelt basically inventing economic rights and even enumerating the economic rights in 1944. Of course, he could not get that passed in the American political system. We're still struggling to get that idea adopted in the American political system. President Biden's talking about those very issues, the idea that every person, irrespective of gender and of race, should have the benefits of these basic economic rights is still not assured. But normatively, this is where we have the establishment in the modern context of this notion of economic rights. So if I can come back to our timeline, in 1941, FDR launched the Four Freedoms, and in 1944, the Economic Bill of Rights. And those economic rights were incorporated then in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And from there, I will talk about how those rights were extended and elaborated to include the physical environment in the 1972 conference in Stockholm. I'll come to that in a moment. And then the Rio Earth Summit. And then the adoption by the United Nations of Millennium Development Goals and of the Sustainable Development Goals. So the Universal Declaration is our next point of building the sustainable development idea. It is promulgated in 1948 in a committee led by Franklin Roosevelt's wife, Eleanor Roosevelt. Truly amazing leader. And it put forward a global set of human rights, including civil, political, and economic rights. And it's very much in the vision of also consistent with the Western ethical tradition that the core of these rights are, as said in Article 1, that all human beings are born free and equal in dignity and rights. They are endowed with reason. There is Aristotle and Plato talking to us. They are endowed with reason and conscience and should act towards one another in a spirit of brotherhood. Article 2, everyone is entitled to all the rights and freedoms set forth in this declaration without distinction of any kind, such as race, color, sex, language, religion, political or other opinion, national or social origin, property, birth, or other status. Furthermore, no distinction shall be made on the basis of the political, jurisdictional, or international status of the country or territory to which a person belongs, whether it be independent, trust, non-self-governing, or under any other limitation of sovereignty. In other words, this was still the colonial era. These are universal human rights. No one should be left behind. I'd like you to read again the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It remains our moral charter for the international community. And I've excerpted some of the rights, the freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. That's from the four freedoms. The freedom of opinion and expression, that's a second of the four freedoms. The freedom to take part in government. The right of equal access to public service, which is part of SDG 16. And then in Article 22, economic, social, and cultural rights that are indispensable for human dignity and the free development of personality. In other words, the rights in the Universal Declaration are political, civil, but also economic, social, and cultural rights. Somehow, American rhetoric and politics has forgotten this over the years because the American rhetoric is usually strong on political rights and attacking, for example, non-democracies, but is very weak on economic, social, and cultural rights because the U.S. does not want to look too closely at our own society and our racial divisions, our gender divisions, and our class divisions, which are profound, unjust, and in violation of the rights of the Universal Declaration. So these economic, social, and cultural rights are then later elaborated and incorporated in a covenant, which is an implementing document adopted in the 1960s to implement the economic, social, and cultural rights in the Universal Declaration. So the Declaration is a statement of principles, and the covenant is the implementing instrument. And the economic rights that are included include worker rights, for example, the right to equal pay for equal work, the right to leisure, the right to a reasonable limitation of working hours, the right to safe and healthy working conditions, the right to join a trade union, the right to strike, the right to social security and social protection, the protection of and assistance to the family. That's what President Biden is asking for, this latest round of family support measures, the right to an adequate standard of living, the right to health, which we certainly do not have in the United States until today, the right to education, and cultural rights. So it's a very ambitious and inclusive agenda that is not realized in practice, but remains the normative framework which all governments have pledged to meet. In 1972, a new issue was adopted in the international diplomatic context, and that was environmental sustainability. Because until 1972, until Earth Day began in 1970, the idea was that nature was inexhaustible and bountiful, and that economic growth was therefore a sole defining goal of society. Of course, we began to understand the ecological limits as the world economy expanded. And in the 1960s, an environmental movement developed in response to the massive chemical pollutants and the discoveries of some of the global scale effects, such as the carbon dioxide emissions and the potential that humankind was warming the planet. And so a major conference was held in Stockholm in 1972. This is the UN Conference on the Human Environment. And the Stockholm conference resulted in a declaration. This will be 50 years ago as of next year. And the declaration in Principle 2 said that the natural resources of the earth, including the air, water, land, flora, and fauna, and especially representative samples of natural ecosystems, must be safeguarded for the benefit of present and future generations through careful planning or management as appropriate. So this was the first idea of intergenerational justice and of ecological sustainability incorporated into global diplomacy. So it's another piece of the sustainable development agenda that is becoming a part of the international diplomacy, added to the human rights agenda. And over the next 40 years, we came to understand that there are, in fact, multiple grave global scale environmental threats: climate change, the loss of biodiversity, massive pollution, and zoonotic events like COVID-19, where a new disease enters the human population from an animal reservoir, in the case of COVID, from horseshoe bats. And that all of these four massive environmental challenges needed to be met by economic regulation. For example, climate change by shifting from fossil fuels to renewable energy, protecting biodiversity by protecting large land areas as natural forest, and stopping the incursion of economic activity into the Amazon or the Congo Basin or Indonesian rainforest, the reduction or elimination of massive pollutants, and of course, better containment and control of zoonotic diseases. So these became added to the sustainable development agenda. Fast forward to the 21st century, and without time to elaborate, at the turn of the 21st century, the world community adopted the turn of the century, I should jump to 1992, the Rio Earth Summit which was 20 years after the Stockholm summit. And at the Rio Earth summit, these issues of environmental crisis came to the forefront. And the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change was adopted, the Convention on Biological Diversity to Preserve Biodiversity was adopted, and the UN Convention to Combat Desertification in Drylands was adopted. Three major multilateral environmental agreements adopted in Rio in 1992, plus the first time that the world governments formally adopted the concept of sustainable development as the organizing principle for global cooperation. So that, we thought, was a breakthrough. Unfortunately, those three environmental treaties were not implemented properly until today. The climate change continues, the loss of biodiversity continues, the spread of degraded land and desertification continues. So even though the treaties were adopted in 1992, sustainable practices for the world economy were not adopted. In the year 2000, the UN adopted a new agenda to promote economic rights, especially to end poverty. And these were called the Millennium Development Goals, or MDGs. And I served as special advisor to UN Secretary General Kofi Annan and then Secretary General Ban Ki-moon on the Millennium Development Goals between the years 2001 and 2015. And the idea of the MDGs was to promote the basic economic rights for people that were living in extreme deprivation. And actually, some notable progress was made in reducing poverty, in getting more children into school, in expanding healthcare coverage, in treating the then lead pandemic diseases, AIDS, TB, and malaria, and in expanding safe water and sanitation. So progress was made, but nowhere near enough to achieve the end of poverty, as should have been the objective given its practical achievability. The world, as usual, was diverted. Domestic politics was always crowding out international concerns. And 9/11 occurred, which shifted American politics almost entirely towards war in the Middle East and away from issues like sustainable development. In 2012, so 12 years into the MDGs and 20 years after the Rio Earth Summit, there was another meeting in Rio de Janeiro, which was a very interesting and in a way sad meeting, because the governments came together 20 years after the Rio Earth Summit, and rather than celebrating the success of the three environmental treaties, they recognized that those three treaties had not been properly implemented. And the upshot was a decision to adopt sustainable development goals as a way to amplify again for the public the importance of the sustainable development agenda. So that's how we went fast forward from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the Stockholm Declaration that brought environment into this picture, the Rio Earth Summit, then the Millennium Development Goals, then the review of the Rio Earth Summit 20 years later, then in 2015, the adoption of the SDGs. And that's where we are today. And I'll conclude by saying some words about how we should regard these sustainable development goals and how to achieve them. First, what would it take to achieve the 17 sustainable development goals? I'd like to summarize the challenge into six major transformations that our societies need. They all reflect basic human rights. They all go back to the Universal Declaration and to the realization of the environmental threats. So the first of these transformations is quality education for all, because without that, no society can function properly and will not achieve any of the other SDGs. Second is access to health care and well-being for all as a basic input to our happiness and to our productivity. Third is clean, that is sustainable energy and industry, so that we stop the environmental destruction through human-induced climate change and unsustainable pollution and waste. Fourth is sustainable land use, so that we stop encroaching on fragile ecosystems and ensure a sustainable food supply. The fifth transformation is smart cities, since about 70% of the world population will live in cities by mid-century, perhaps even higher. We need cities that work properly, that are safe, productive, efficient, and inclusive. And increasingly, that also means digital and based on renewables. And the sixth transformation, I would say, that's fundamental to achieving the Sustainable Development Goals are the new digital technologies. Because as we know from our daily lives, every day and increasingly, we need digital access for all of the rest of the goals, for education, for healthcare, for renewable energy, for effective land management, for smart cities. They're all building on the digital technologies. And so we need to build an effective and inclusive online society. So these are the six major transformations that I think are crucial in order to bring about sustainable development. What do they have in common? They all are a major change in how our societies function. They require long-term investments. They require both public and private investments. They require long-term planning. They require finance, both public and private. And they require a mix of public policies, economic, political, and social. I emphasize all of this because, in my view, politics should not be about what do we do this year, what do we do in the next 6 months. Politics should be about the major transformations that our societies need to be prosperous, inclusive, and sustainable. And if we can make those major investments, we can build the future of well-being that we're aiming for. It's a big challenge. Let me emphasize the centrality of education in all of it. It seems to me that education plays at least three fundamental roles. One is developing skills. Skills are important for livelihoods, for earnings, for productivity. But second, education builds character. This was a fundamental point of both Plato in the Republic and Aristotle in the Politics, that education is the basis of building virtue. And third, education is vital for good citizenship. We need to know the truths of our societies in order to be effective citizens. And so education, I think, is the sine qua non of all of the investments that need to be made or the primus inter pares, at least the first among equals, of all of the investments that need to be made for the success of the sustainable development goals. A quick word about this broad kind of social transformation. How can one make global scale social change? Well, it's not easy. The only way to do it is to start with the goals and then work towards a shared set of objectives. But many points that I would emphasize, this is a more holistic agenda than normal politics or normal economics. It definitely involves government, business, and civil society. It involves governments at all level, from the local to the global. Businesses in every sector need to be engaged. The financial sector, Wall Street, has a huge role to play because Wall Street channels saving to investments. And if it applies an environmental, social, and governance lens, an ESG lens, then the investment contributes to sustainable development. If the funding is channeled to polluting fossil fuels, then, of course, it undermines the sustainable development agenda. Civil society, all of us as citizens, as consumers, as protesters, as advocates, have a large role to play. And the United Nations, as the backbone of the international system, has a unique central role. And I mentioned two things on the graph. HLPF stands for High Level Political Forum. It is the framework for intergovernmental monitoring of the SDGs. And the Quadrennial Summit is the idea that every 4 years, all of the heads of state should meet to discuss progress towards the sustainable development goals. There are many issues about this complex agenda and this complex governance. One core political idea is subsidiarity, which is that government is needed at all levels, from local councils to states to national to regional to global. But the right level of government for a particular challenge depends on the nature of that challenge. When it's truly a global goal, like climate change, we need a global framework. When it is a national objective, like national infrastructure, then we need the federal government to act. When it's a local challenge, for example, maybe local schools or clinics, that is the purview of the local government. So subsidiarity, which is also a Catholic Church doctrine, says that problems should be addressed at the lowest level, consistent with solving the problem. But for some problems, that means the global level, because climate change and poverty eradication can only be accomplished through global cooperation. I go through, and I won't delay and belabor the points now about the multiple roles of government, except to emphasize that we need activist governments in investments, services, financing, regulation, legal framework, planning, if we are to succeed. This is what President Biden is rightly emphasizing. We need an activist federal government. The Republican Party has been advocating for the last 40 years a libertarian vision of a highly constricted, minimal government that doesn't regulate, that doesn't invest, that doesn't redistribute. And that vision of a minimal government is inconsistent with achieving the triple objectives of the Sustainable Development Goals. We need businesses aligned with the Sustainable Development Goals for their own long-term sense of markets and for their ethics, in which an ethical company does not aim to make profits at the cost imposed on others, but only through the true social value that is added by the company's own operations. We need civil society in countless ways as citizens, consumers, us in schools and universities, not-for-profit businesses, and activism, such as the divestment movement. And we need to be knowledgeable and attentive about specific objectives, like the challenge of decarbonizing the energy system by mid-century, to be consistent with not only SDG 13, but also the Paris Climate Agreement, because that's the only way, decarbonizing by mid-century, to ensure that we, or not to ensure, but to have a good chance that we'll stay below the 1.5 degrees Celsius warming that has been identified as a danger threshold that we should stay below. We're fighting to do so. Again, President Biden has done the right thing by convening world leaders last month to commit together to decarbonize by mid-century. And he made a lot of progress in that White House virtual summit that he hosted. But we still don't have the world on side for that. Similarly, we're going to need global agreements on the world food supply to ensure sustainability of the global food supply and that the production of food does not by itself create massive environmental damage, such as the deforestation of the Amazon. So there are many different aspects of public policy formation in order to achieve sustainable development. I list a number here: identifying technologies, financing, policies, subsidiarity, research and development, a whole large agenda. Suffice it to say that none of this looks like a free market economy. All of it is economics. All of it is about directing resources, but very little of it is about the market allocation of these resources, because we're aiming to shift the way that resources are used in an identifiable direction, which is different from what the market forces are suggesting. This also requires that we adopt industrial policies, meaning that the government promotes particular sectors for development. And the U.S. has done this many times in the past, for example, in the moonshot, creating the space sector, space industry and space science, creation of the internet, which was a product first of the Defense Department, and then it became a worldwide public good. The Human Genome Project, which was a government-sponsored program to sequence the human genome, and that was completely essential for the development of the vaccines recently, the science that was advanced during the Human Genome Project. We have a neuroscience program that is similar, and a major program for self-driving vehicles and electric vehicles. Again, President Kennedy was a champion of this kind of industrial policy. Perhaps most famously, was his pronouncement calling on the U.S. to take up the moonshot, which in May 1961, so we're in the 60th anniversary of the moonshot coming up in just 3 weeks from today, President Kennedy said, "I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before the decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth. No single space project in this period will be more impressive to mankind or more important for the long-range exploration of space, and none will be so difficult or expensive to accomplish." But of course, 8 years later, Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin walked on the moon. It was a successful venture that before the decade is out, the U.S. would send men to the moon and return them safely to the Earth. So that is a kind of industrial policy that we're going to need, for example, for transforming our energy system. And China is adopting a similar kind of industrial strategy for the main sustainable technologies. Suffice it to say that to mobilize resources for the human good, for example, directing them to renewable energy or to land use conservation or to mass immunization, we need to use the budget. And therefore, the ability to tax is critical to the ability to achieve sustainable development. And the United States is a low tax country, which is one of our biggest ideological barriers. And interestingly, President Biden has proposed a big increase of taxes, and or it's not huge, but meaningful. And the Republican Party has said not a cent of new taxes. And so this is where ideology clouds sustainability. But President Biden is absolutely on the right side of this, in my opinion, because we need to move resources towards sustainable development. And that requires the mobilization of public financing. Core to all of this, of course, is moral advocacy. Pope Francis's leadership on sustainable development has not only been exemplary, it's been crucial. Laudato Si is a vital encyclical that influenced world leaders around the world, as well as the publics around the world. And in the encyclical, Pope Francis said that our interdependence obliges us to think of one world with a common plan. And this is so wonderful because it really is the inspiration for a common plan around sustainable development. And Pope Francis has gathered other world leaders around the other world religious leaders around this shared vision. And this is a picture that I took the day that the sustainable development goals were adopted in the General Assembly. You can see perhaps Pope Francis in the center there. He had just given his address. The world leaders stood up to applaud, and then they adopted the 17 sustainable development goals. Let me mention that in 2023, we will be at the 75th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and I am hoping that we will use that occasion to update and reaffirm the commitment to basic human rights, including economic rights, and that we can also emphasize at the time the need for universal duties or responsibilities in budgeting and tax systems and social protection and corporate accountability to accompany the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. So stay tuned. I'm going to be trying to make a public campaign around the 75th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights to offer and suggest some updates for the 21st century. Universities have a crucial role to play in this agenda, and I regard Fordham as a leader in this with hosting this course and with the view to upgrading and I'd say modernizing the economics and social science curricula to be compatible with sustainable development. This is a map a little bit out of date right now of member institutions of the Sustainable Development Solutions Network, which I'm happy to direct for Secretary General Guterres, of universities around the world committed to the theme of sustainable development as our shared common pathway. Finally, I want to end with the President Kennedy and about peace, because all of what we're saying requires a culture of peace and a commitment to global cooperation. And President Kennedy gave the most important modern speech about peace in 1963, after the Cuban Missile Crisis, when he was promoting the idea that the United States and the Soviet Union need to work together, and that they could work together even though they were adversaries. And I want to close by emphasizing the point that the United States needs to work with every other country. And in our present day, I underscore China, we need to work cooperatively with China in order to achieve the sustainable development goals. We can't afford a Cold War that will divert us. And I wanted to share with you just a piece of President Kennedy's speech that day, because I think it is a monumentally brilliant speech. In this speech, President Kennedy was speaking about the need to make peace with the Soviet Union, which the American people regarded as the great adversarial power. And they say, how can we make peace with that country? And what President Kennedy does in these brief remarks, these 3 minutes that I want to play for you, is praise the Soviet people and emphasize to the American people that we can make peace with the people of the Soviet Union, indeed the people of the world, because we share a common global fate. So let's close by listening to President Kennedy's words. Let me know if you can't hear for some reason, and I'll reload, but let's try.
No government or social system is so evil that its people must be considered as lacking in virtue. As Americans, we find communism profoundly repugnant as a negation of personal freedom and dignity. But we can still hail the Russian people for their many achievements in science and space, in economic and industrial growth, in culture, in acts of courage. Among the many traits the peoples of our two countries have in common, none is stronger than our mutual abhorrence of war. Almost unique, among the major world powers, we have never been at war with each other. And no nation in the history of battle ever suffered more than the Soviet Union in the Second World War. At least 20 million lost their lives. Countless millions of homes and families were burned or sacked. A third of the nation's territory, including two-thirds of its industrial base, was turned into a wasteland, a loss equivalent to the destruction of this country east of Chicago. Today, should total war ever break out again, no matter how, our two countries will be the primary target. It is an ironic but accurate fact that the two strongest powers are the two in the most danger of devastation. All we have built, all we have worked for, would be destroyed in the first 24 hours. And even in the Cold War, which brings burdens and dangers to so many countries, including this nation's closest allies, our two countries bear the heaviest burdens. For we are both devoting massive sums of money to weapons that could be better devoted to combat ignorance, poverty, and disease. We are both caught up in a vicious and dangerous cycle, with suspicion on one side breeding suspicion on the other, and new weapons begetting counterweapons. In short, both the United States and its allies, and the Soviet Union and its allies, have a mutually deep interest in a just and genuine peace and in halting the arms race. Agreements to this end are in the interests of the Soviet Union as well as ours. And even the most hostile nations can be relied upon to accept and keep those treaty obligations, and only those treaty obligations, which are in their own interest. So let us not be blind to our differences, but let us also direct attention to our common interests and the means by which those differences can be resolved. And if we cannot end now our differences, at least we can help make the world safe for diversity. For in the final analysis, our most basic common link is that we all inhabit this small planet. We all breathe the same air. We all cherish our children's futures, and we are all mortal.
So there you have it. We all share this small planet. We all breathe the same air. We all cherish our children's futures. We are all mortal. It is our responsibility to make something of those common facts. So let's make the world the kind of place we want it to be. That is the essence of good economics. That is the essence of good ethics. Thank you very much for sharing the course. I will not see you on Friday, but Tony will pick up here, and best wishes on the exam next week as well. So Tony, maybe a couple closing words to you.
Well, yes. So we will meet again one last time on Friday, even though it's technically going over the day of last class, but we will have one more meeting. We will be talking a lot about Pope Francis's Laudato Si, what Professor Sachs just talked about. And we'll just see you on Friday. But let's thank Professor Sachs for a wonderful semester. I think this was a very interesting and a great experiment that we did here. So, yeah.
Thanks to you. Thanks to everybody. Wonderful to be together. And we continue in this great journey. So thanks, everybody.
Okay. See you all on Friday for one, as they say in Hamilton, one last time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sachs.
Thank you, Professor Sachs. Have a great summer.
Okay. Take care. I'm going to shut this down now.